Okay, so today I'm going to talk about effective field theory at tree level. Does anybody have any questions first about yesterday's lecture? I have to apologize in advance. They've turned the gain up really loud, and I've got a really bad cold. So at some point, I'm going to sneeze, and all of you are going to go crazy because it's going to blow you out of your chairs. Okay. So effective field theory at tree level is really just dimensional analysis. And the idea is that when you have high dimension operators, the coefficients have dimensions of inverse powers of mass. So when they enter scattering amplitudes, in order to get a cross section which has dimension of area, you're going to get powers of energy upstairs to compensate for the powers of mass downstairs. And so at energies far below the scale of your effective field theory, these will be very weak contributions. So the first step is just to understand how to do the power counting. And so I'm going to start off with a sort of generic effective field theory, very simple one, just only involves scalar fields. So I'm going to talk about a Lagrangian where I start off with the usual renormalizable kinetic term and the mass term, and then a phi-fourth coupling. And I don't stop, though. I keep going. And I'll have a whole bunch of operators of the form that look like Cn over lambda to the 2n phi of 4 plus 2n. And I'll have another tower of operators, which have an extra couple of derivatives acting on the phi. So what I've done there is I've written down the idea is what you do in an effective field theory is you only include your light degrees of freedom. You've integrated out some heavy stuff, and you keep only the light degrees of freedom, and then you include all operators allowed by the symmetry. And in this case, I've chosen to write a theory with a symmetry that is a phi goes to minus phi symmetry, and so I only put in even powers of phi. But I can't stop at any, and then of course Lorentz invariance tells me that the derivatives have to come in pairs, but other than that, just all possible operators. Now, when we do dimension counting, then we define mass dimension, and I use a shorthand notation for that. I'll say that I'll use square brackets to define the mass dimension. So I'll say the mass dimension of a momentum is 1. That means it scales like mass. The mass dimension of a coordinate is minus 1, or time. Derivative, of course, then scales like momentum, and so on. And then what we say is that the action, because, I mean, the easy way to remember is that in the path integral, you have e to the I s over h bar, so the action is dimensionless. And therefore, in four dimensions, the dimension of the Lagrange density is 4, because the dimension of the integration over spacetime is minus 4. Now, of course, that changes in different dimensions. And that's why field theories in different dimensions are going to behave completely differently. Now, normally what one does then is you say, oh, well, let me figure out what the dimension of the scalar field is by saying that this has to have dimension 4. Because I like to normalize my fields so that there's no coupling constant in front of it. So I usually say then that d phi squared equals 4, and therefore phi has dimension 1. Now, it always bothered me. I've got a whole bunch of operators here. Why did I choose to normalize it so that this had the coefficient 1 and everything else had some coupling constant whose dimension I have to determine? Why don't I say that the phi to the sixth term comes with a coefficient 1, and then I say, oh, that means that phi has dimension 2/3, and then I put dimensionful coefficients here. So what is special about the kinetic term? So to understand what's special about the kinetic term, it's useful to look at a path integral. Let's go to Euclidean spacetime. And ask, what are the fluctuations in the field or the contributions in the integral that are most important? Now, a path integral is a horrible thing. It's such a huge space you're integrating over. I'm going to whittle it down to something manageable. I'm going to look at a very particular form for phi, which has a sort of a shape like this. It's called a wavelet. And what I'm doing for this is that this is going to be phi sub, so there's going to be a typical size, which is L is about equal to 2 pi over k, and a typical wavelength, is going to be k, so that means that if I take d mu phi, the amplitude, I'm going to call phi sub k. And so what this is a wavelength that it's not a plane wave, because plane waves are nasty to work with because they spread over infinite volume. So I'm going to take something where the derivative is approximately equal to k phi k. And if I integrated d4x, say phi squared, I would get phi k squared, the amplitude, times the volume integral over something that's this extent, which is 2 pi over k to the fourth. So this is not equal, it's approximately equal. So this is a little chunk of field that is localized in space and has roughly wave number k. It's just a tool that makes it a little bit easier to analyze. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to reduce my path integral into an ordinary integral where I'm just integrating over all possible amplitudes for this particular funny field configuration. And then the question is, which of these terms here dominates and how important is each term? So I'm really just doing this integral, an ordinary integral over the amplitude of this field, e to the minus the action. Okay, well, you know that if you have an integral like this, that you'll get contributions for all values of phi k for which s is less than roughly 1. And that if you have contributions for which make s very large, that's going to damp out and not contribute to the integral. So clearly, if phi k gets very large, the action is going to be very large and won't contribute. So the question is, which of these operators shuts off the integral first? So to see that, it's convenient to rescale. First of all, let me rewrite what the action is. When I stick in this funny field configuration. And so first of all, my integral d4x is going to give me a factor 2 pi over k to the fourth. So this is a squiggle. And then what do I get? I get that this d phi will give me a k phi k squared over 2. This will give me a 1/2 m squared phi k squared plus lambda over 4 factorial phi k to the fourth. By the way, I write my phis in various ways. They're all the same. So and this one is just phi k to the 4 plus 2n. And then I get the d term is going to have an extra power of k in it, k squared. And now, in order to make this a little bit simpler to read, I'm going to define a dimensionless phi k hat, which is phi k over k. And so finally, when I rewrite it that way, all the k's are going to disappear. So I get a 2 pi to the fourth. And then this becomes a phi k hat squared over 2. Because I had a k squared divided by k fourth, which is 1 over k squared. So I have a phi k squared over k squared, which is just phi hat squared. And then I have a 1 half m squared over k squared times phi k hat squared plus a lambda over 4 factorial phi k hat to the fourth plus sum on n cn over cn times k to over lambda to the 2n phi k hat to the 4 plus 2n plus sum on n dn k over lambda to the 2n phi k hat to the 2n plus 2. So everything is dimensionless now. I should have, yeah. And the k's have they only appear paired up either with the lambdas that I put in there. I put them in there ahead of time to make the c's and d's dimensionless, and the m squared here. So now, as phi k gets large, so, well, now I've got to make a couple assumptions about the coupling constants in this theory. So I'm going to assume that my d's and c's are and lambda are small, so that perturbation theory will work. But the one other thing I have to make an assumption about here is this term here. So I'm also, for now, going to make the assumption that m squared over k squared is also much less than 1, which means that it's relativistic. Now, if you do that, then you get to the point where you see as I integrate over phi hat k, as k phi hat goes from 0 to infinity, that the first term in this series that's going to get large is this term. Because first of all, it doesn't have a small coupling in front of it, like this one does. Because by assumption, that's a small coupling, m squared over k squared. But also, these terms are higher order, and they're suppressed by k over lambda. So I should have also said that I'm assuming that k is much less than lambda. So as long as I'm looking at low energy and relativistic particles, then you see that this is the term that determines the size of fluctuations. And that is why the kinetic term has a special role in the Lagrangian. That's why we determine our dimensions based on the kinetic term. Yeah?
Does that mean that if we want to study the non-relativistic
case, then
we better
put
a coefficient
1
for the mass?
Yes. So when it becomes non-relativistic, everything changes. The dimensions get dominated by this term, and you want to redefine your theory, how you do your scaling. And that is why, for example, in quantum mechanics, you use a wave function that has dimension 3/2. But in relativistic scalar theory, you have a field that has dimension 1. So when you go to a non-relativistic theory, you're going to redefine the theory. So for example, when you have, I can write the kinetic term like this. And the problem is, for a non-relativistic particle, these things almost cancel, and it's not very useful to do power counting like this. So what you do is you define phi equals e to the minus I m t psi. And if you do that, and you plug that in, and you say that I'm going to keep psi dot, but drop psi double dot, because the idea is I've got a fast frequency there from the rest mass, but the time dependence of psi has to do with the kinetic energy, which by assumption is small because it's non-relativistic, small compared to m. When you do that, this becomes let me do this for a complex field that's a little less confusing. So if I put a complex scalar field, then this becomes psi dagger. And then the dt squared and the m squared are going to cancel. That's the fine tuning that you get when you go to, right, use relativistic language for a non-relativistic field. And then you're left with a d by dt, and there's an i, and there's an m, minus i m, because one of the derivatives brings down the minus im, and then you've got a del squared still, and that's it, because I'm dropping the second time derivative. And now what you do is you say, well, this is not very convenient, having an m next to the d by dt, so in my definition I will put in a square root of 2m here. And when I do that, then this goes away, and you get an m over here, and now it looks like that Lagrangian I wrote down yesterday. But now the dimensions are sort of funny, because first of all, you'll find that psi is dimension 3/2, and you'll also find that time scales differently than space, because there's a linear derivative here. So your whole scaling goes different when you get down to a non-relativistic theory. So that's one of the ways you can avoid some of those assumptions, is that if you become non-relativistic, your power counting changes. Another thing that can cause power counting to change is if you had a very large value for some of these couplings, then all bets are off, okay? This no longer is dominated necessarily by the kinetic term. It could be a 5/4 interaction or something higher that becomes really important. Now, typically, theories like that, if you were to define this, say, on a lattice field theory, and I made some of these couplings strong, the lattice theory undergoes what's called a first-order phase transition, where you suddenly get a rearrangement of all your degrees of freedom, and there's nothing light in the theory left over. And so actually, it does not correspond to a continuum field theory. If you try to just write this down as a continuum field theory and throw in a huge number there, typically it doesn't make sense as a continuum field theory anymore. But sometimes it can, such as in the Nambujono-Osinio model, where there are light degrees of freedom and there's a second order phase transition in the lattice language. Anyway, so that's what's behind why we, for relativistic theory, we use the kinetic term to determine dimensions. Okay. So are you talking about this?
So the point is that if we have started from a different assumption, so for example at phi 6 was the one in the last dimension 0, so with phi dimension 2/3, and so just using a different.
Okay, so this is just a change of variables in the Lagrangian. There's no physics in this, okay? I'm fixing k and integrating over this.
Okay.
Okay. It didn't matter that it is dimensionless or not. You can just still do this change of variables, and it ends up with it makes it easier to see that this leading term is the one that dominates. But it's still true in the original theory too. It's just it's a little bit more confusing. Right. Yeah, I mean, you don't have to use this definition. You can work here and see that this is the term that dominates. Okay. So this form here is also interesting to ask, what is the relative importance of these terms for different values of k? And so one thing we saw immediately was that if k got small, then this becomes more important. Now, as k gets small, these guys get less and less important, okay? So these are what are called the irrelevant operators, because they get so unimportant for small k, and these are called the relevant operators because they get more important, and this is the marginal operator because it doesn't change in the phi hat language. So phi hat is the natural variable once you've decided that this is the operator you should be looking at. So the only reason I use that wavelet is just so I don't have to put it in a box and use powers of volume, and it gets a little very confusing. Okay, so let's, so why is dimension counting useful? Well, you immediately see that this irrelevance of how the irrelevance of higher dimension operators works. So let's look at the Fermi theory. So you've got an Lagrangian which has some Dirac fermions, and then you've got this G Fermi psi bar psi squared. And by the power counting that we just outlined, if this is dimension 4, that implies that the dimension of psi is 3/2. And therefore, the dimension of psi bar psi squared is 6. And since the Lagrangian has to have dimension of mass to the fourth, that means that G Fermi will have dimension 1 over mass squared. Now, when you calculate a scattering process, like for neutron decay, you've got this Feynman rule like this, and this goes like G Fermi, because it's a tree-level graph, and that's the coupling. And therefore, you know that the cross-section must be proportional to G Fermi squared, just because it's the square of the amplitude. But a cross-section has dimension of area, which is minus 2, and G Fermi has dimension of minus 2. G Fermi squared is dimension minus 4, and so you have to have two powers of dimension upstairs. So you're going to have to get it from the phase space integral, so you're going to get some energy squared here. Okay, now, what is the energy? Well, you have to do your phase space integral to get it exactly, but for neutron decay, it's the rest mass energy is not being released here. It's not relevant for the phase space. All the energy that is relevant for phase space is basically the energy difference between the neutron and the proton. So you're going to get something that looks like MeV, because that's about the energy released. Okay, and G Fermi is equal to 10 to the minus 5 over GeV squared. And so you can see that this is a very tiny cross-section, okay? And similarly, for neutrino scattering, you get something similar from Z exchange, which also goes like G Fermi. And so now you're going to find that the cross-section goes like you have a G Fermi squared here, and the only dimensionful quantity in neutrino scattering, since the masses of the neutrinos are irrelevant, is the center of mass energy squared, so that's S. And so you find, you know, just from the dimension counting, you see that at, you know, the low energy scattering, you're going to have an extremely weak interaction, low energy being MeV. So it just follows just from dimensions that the weak interactions are weak, but it also tells you that something is going to go wrong when S gets on the order of 100 GeV. The theory is going to break down completely, because now this operator that you've got there ends up being order, the G Fermi S is order 1, so that tells you that you're somehow expanding in 1. And in fact, this operator is, you can't ignore the next operator, which has a couple extra derivatives, or 4 derivatives, or 6 derivatives. And so, of course, what's happened is you've gotten up to the scale of the W and Z masses which are producing this thing, and that's where your effective field theory is completely broken down. So, that's good, but of course, so this is one type of application of effective field theory, and this is what I would call it was originally what I would have called a bottom-up use of EFT, where you start off with a theory you understand, which at the time was QED, and you ask, what sort of operators can I add to QED that are consistent with the symmetries of QED? And by symmetries, really the only one that should count is the gauge symmetry. So Fermi has to write down a theory, an extra set of operators that do not violate electric charge. But other than that, he's free to write down all possible operators that violate global symmetries, such as strangeness or neutron number. Okay, and then he could say, okay, I've got these operators that if G Fermi is extremely high, corresponds to an inverse large mass scale, then this is a very small effect, and now I can go and ask, are any of these effects visible? Well, if you tried to write down an effective operator that had the same structure as photon exchange, you'd never see it, because it would be swamped by the tree-level photon exchange. But if the higher dimension operator violates one of the symmetries of the lower dimension operators, symmetries of QED, then it'll be the leading effect. And so it, for example, violation of neutron number, it's the leading effect and it's very visible. So this is how people expand their understanding of field theories. They throw in these extra operators, they look for these effects, and when they see them, whether it's, you know, neutron decay or proton decay or you know, flavor changing effects or neutrino masses, then you've got a clue to what the next stage is going to be, and you say, well, this is an effective operator, there's some full theory up there that gave rise to it, can I guess what it is? Okay, and it took 30 years to go from Fermi's theory to the standard model. Nowadays, of course, we have the standard model, so we don't use this in the same way. Now this is actually treated as a bottom-down type, top-down use, where we have a complicated, very good theory at high energy, but if we're doing MEV scattering or neutron decay, we don't need all of that machinery to describe what's going on, because when your expansion is on the order of G Fermi times 1 MeV squared, that's a great expansion, okay? We don't need the higher order effects. We don't need all that artillery with the Z exchange and W exchange and so on. So if you want to, unless you want to go to extremely high precision, then you can use the Fermi theory now as a very good approximation to the standard model, which is a lot less work, okay? So that's sort of a different use where you have a complicated high energy theory and you want to just talk about the simple description of low energy physics. And this is going to be even more apparent when I talk about chiral perturbation theory, where we have a great theory of the strong interactions called QCD, but we cannot use it to calculate properties of mesons without using a computer. So if we want to do some analysis of meson-meson scattering, we construct an effective low-energy theory, and we will have a bunch of operators with coefficients that we have to fit to experiment because we don't know how to compute them from first principles without a computer. But that effective theory can still be very predictive. So that's a second use of effective field theory. So let me first just remind you how the Fermi theory works. So we can describe the weak interaction in terms of two currents. The first one is the electromagnetic current, which is 2/3 times U bar gamma mu. So these I's running over families, 1, 2, 3. And then we also need the SU2 left currents. Where I'm going to write it as just a sum over fields, where the fields can either be the lepton fields, which are nu e, nu mu, mu, nu tau, tau, or the quark fields, u d prime, c s prime, t b prime, where the primed fields are the ones that are rotated from the, which are, these are the what are called the flavor eigenstates, and they're rotated from the mass eigenstates by qi prime equals vij qj, where v equals the CKM matrix. Okay, and then in terms of these currents, what we have in the standard model is we have the following interactions with the W and Z. I'll show you in a moment what those are. And Okay, so the currents, J plus minus, are J1 plus or minus I J2 over square root of 2, where the 1 and 2 correspond to the index A, the isospin, the SU2 index. So this is what the currents are in the standard model in terms of the W and Z. Okay, and so in the full theory, now if you want to look at, if you want to construct the low energy effective theory, you have to integrate out the W and the Z. So formally, an effective theory is you do the path integral over the heavy fields and you leave in the light fields, and so that's called integrating out the heavy fields. So we're going to integrate out the W and the Z and look at the effective theory that just involve quarks and leptons. So we do this in perturbation theory, and at tree level, you just have to integrate out by computing those diagrams. And so, for example, it's very easy to see then that the Feynman amplitude, when you do this, is going to have the form minus I. So let's do the charge current, the W. E over sine theta W squared times J mu plus J mu minus times the propagator for the W, and that's going to be 1 over Q squared minus MW squared with a minus I G mu nu upstairs. Now, if you had chosen a different propagator with the Q mu's and Q nu's, they'd be contracted with these currents, which are conserved currents up to masses of the quarks, and so it wouldn't make a difference at this order. So you write that's the full tree level amplitude, but now you can Taylor expand that, and so that's minus I E squared over sine squared theta W. MW squared. Sorry, this should have been new. U nu here. Now I contract them because of the G. And this gets matched then onto a contact interaction. So this is plus order Q squared over MW squared. And so the whole point of matching is we want to write down the effective field theory, and it's supposed to be designed to get exactly the same S matrix elements. So if the S matrix element is this to leading order and Q squared over M squared in the full theory, it's got to be the same in the effective theory. So the effective theory then can be written as having this operator 8 over square root of 2 G Fermi J mu minus J mu plus, where G Fermi is equal to square root of 2 over 8 times E squared over sine squared theta W MW squared. And experimentally, it's found to be this number here. You'll probably not see this factor of 8 over root 2 in the old textbooks because they normalize their currents differently. This is the nice way to normalize the currents now that we have the standard model. But G Fermi, of course, is the same. So you see then G Fermi is now expressed in terms of more fundamental parameters, the weak angle and the W mass and the electric charge. It does not allow you to immediately figure out what the W mass is because there's this angle in there, or equivalently, this combination here is what was called G2 squared, the SU2 coupling constant squared. And so the propagator, since this diagram has something that's suppressed by the mass, but it's also got the coupling constants at the vertices, just seeing the effective operator does not allow you to immediately know what the W mass is. And that's why though well before the Weinberg-Slom model, people had guessed that maybe there was a particle being exchanged. There was no idea of how heavy it was, and that's why Veltman could wonder whether maybe it was a few GeV, even in the mid-60s. So this is, you know, the usual particle physics discussion of effective field theory. And as I said, it gives the dimensions of G Fermi, tell you immediately that the weak interactions are going to be weak at low energy. Another little less common application of effective field theory is what I'm going to tell you next. And it's sort of a classic PhD oral exam question in the States is, why is the sky blue? It's considered a rite of passage that the person has to be humiliated at some point during the exam. When I was a graduate student, I discovered a room at Harvard that served, that was for the faculty, and it served free coffee. Okay, so of course I went there all the time. It was intended only for the faculty, but there's no sign saying it was only for faculty. So I sat there and I got to overhear some pretty interesting conversations, including one between these two very, they seemed like ancient professors to me at the time. And one of them was saying that he just went to a PhD exam and the student showed up wearing no shoes. And the other professor said, "Oh my God, what did you do?" He said, "Well, I failed him, of course." So I thought, okay, checklist for PhD exam, wear shoes. So, so first question, why is the sky blue? But of course, the important question is, why is this an effective field theory problem? So here's the sun up in the sky, and I'm looking over here, and my eye is down here, and some light's got from the sun down to my eye, and it looks blue. So it looks blue when I'm looking away from the sun. So what we're really talking about is, why does blue light scatter more than red light? And the scattering problem is, we have an atom here, and we've got some light. Now, the size of an atom is on the order of an angstrom, and the wavelength of light is on the order of several thousand angstroms. Therefore, this light's not going to resolve the internal structure of the atom. And I would hope that I could understand something about this scattering process without having to do detailed atomic orbital calculations. Because another way of saying it is the excitation energy in the atom is on the order of maybe tens of EV. While this might have an energy of 1 EV. Or less, actually. So whenever you see a ratio, a dimensionless number that you can make, in fact, this is true in physics everywhere, anytime you can make a dimensionless number that's less than 1, you use it, okay? Whether it's 1 over the number of space-time dimensions, or the 1 over the number of colors, or the ratio of two different energies. So here, we're going to use it, and we're going to say, we can have an effective field theory where I treat the atom as a neutral point particle, and I have to ask, how does light scatter off of a neutral particle? Well, I can't use the kinetic term that I normally write down that couples photons to electrons or photons to charged scalar fields, because this has charge 0. It's a neutral atom. So how do I couple photons to neutral atoms? Well, I want to write down a theory that has some degree of freedom for the atom, some degree of freedom for the photon, and my guiding principle is it's got to obey all the symmetries that I know photons obey. In particular, it's got to be gauge invariant. Now, of course, it does not have to be Lorentz invariant, because this atom's a big, heavy atom. But it's a little bit tricky to Photons are always relativistic. There's no such thing as a non-relativistic photon. So how do you write down a theory that's non-relativistic for the atom but relativistic for the photon? And a trick one can use is do it in terms of the four velocity of the atom. And then write down a theory that is relativistic in terms of this four velocity and the photons. And in the end, if you want to work in the restring of the atom where the four velocity looks like this in the restring, you can do that at the end of the calculation. But we'll keep that velocity in there as a parameter in our Lagrangian. So we're really not going to talk about coupling photons to any old atom. We'll talk about coupling photons to an atom that has this four velocity. So we have this extra parameter that we can use in our theory as long as the mu's are, the indices are coupled, are contracted properly. So for the interaction between this atom and the photon, we could draw a picture of it. We have the atom coming along, and we have the photon coming along. And we can't write down pictures like that because photons do not couple directly to neutral particles. But we could draw something like this. Because what we really know is going on is if I looked at this through a magnifying glass, what's happened is the photon has come down. It's excited the atom, and then the atom de-excites and then gets re-emitted. But the whole point is this is the internal structure of the atom coming into play, and I'm contracting that to a point. So in terms of an operator then, I want something that will create and destroy an atom and couple it to photons. But the photons have to be coupled in a gauge invariant way, so it can't involve covariant derivatives. It'll only involve field strength tensors. So an obvious thing to do is to have one that looks like phi dagger phi, where this is my atom field, times F mu nu, F mu nu. That's one thing I could do. But I also have this parameter V mu around here, so I could also do something that looks like phi dagger phi, V alpha F mu alpha times V beta F mu beta. That's another thing. If I try to write down another one which has two V's contracted with F, I'll get zero because F's antisymmetric in its indices. So really, these are the only two that I can write down that will involve two F's and two phi's without having more derivatives. I can write down operators with more derivatives, like derivatives acting on the photons or acting on the phi field, but those would be higher dimension. So these are the lowest dimension ones that I know how to write down. Now, whenever you see two independent operators, then you should say, well, there are two independent ways of, you need two experiments to measure these, and these numbers should have names. It should be well known that light can scatter off a neutral atom in two different ways. And indeed, these are called, or some linear combination of these are called the electric and magnetic polarizabilities of the atom. Okay, so now, what are the dimensions? Well, I'm not going to go into the details, but because phi is non-relativistic, we're going to use that scaling we talked about earlier, where we're going to take phi is 3/2. It's going to have the Schrodinger-like kinetic term that I wrote down. The photon has dimension 1. F mu nu has dimension 2. So we have 2, 2, 3 for these guys. So it looks like it's dimension 7. And therefore, these C's should have dimension minus 3. So these C's have to have dimension 1 over mass cubed. So, any idea what scale you'd put in there for C? Sorry, what? So certainly the theory is going to break down if the energy is going to be. I agree that you should expect an expansion in powers of this. Because as you point out, that if you have energies that can excite that into the next state, then you're no longer treating this as just a solid object. But at low energies, so it's a little bit of a complicated theory. So you'd expect that as you go to higher dimension operators, as you put in more derivatives, indeed, it should be suppressed by powers of delta E. But extremely low photons are insensitive to that, and I want to claim that it just sees a ball of charges, and it's going to scatter off the geometric size of the atom. That's what it's going to see. How big is the atom? So what's going to happen is that these Cs, you expect to go like R0 cubed, where R0 equals the size of the atom, which is on the order of the Bohr radius, which is the angstrom length scale that I mentioned to you. So, but even if that turned out to be incorrect, we could still ask, how does the cross-section scale with energy? So, what do we get then? We find then that the so the cross-section, if I take the squared, is going to be proportional to R0 to the 6, which is a length scale to the 6. But what is the dimension of the cross-section? It's an area, right? But this goes like length to the 6. So what do I need to multiply it? Some energy to the fourth. What energy is in the problem? Just the energy of the photon. So even if we were wildly wrong about the scale of R0, the size, we still have a solid result that the leading cross-section for light scattering off a neutral atom should go like the energy of the photon to the fourth power. This is called Rayleigh scattering. Do I know how to spell really? I think it's this. So, you know, I had a realization that was quite stunning to me when I took a sabbatical in Spain, and I suddenly realized that every word in Spanish is spelled exactly how it sounds. Okay, English and American children spend an inordinate part of their education learning how to spell words. And I suddenly realized, my God, the Spanish never have to do that. And we've got contests called spelling bees, where you give a word you give a kid a complicated word, and then they have to stand up and spell it, and you have this contest. And the whole idea was ludicrous to the Spanish. So anyway, I just said that because this is a ridiculous way to spell a name. But that's what we get for mixing French with Dutch. Okay, so what we got now is that the scattering goes like the energy to the fourth, and so of course blue light scatters much more strongly than red light, which explains roughly why the sky looks blue when we look away from the sun. So apparently there's a story of somebody at Caltech who was well prepared for his PhD exam and learned all about Rayleigh scattering, and then Feynman asked him, why are clouds white? Any questions about this? Okay, so we don't want to spend a lot of time thinking about what Fermi did in the 30s. We want to do it ourselves and take particle physics to the next step. So the question then becomes, what are the effective operators? What could add to the standard model? Now, you might have thought that is such an obvious question. People would have sat down and done it right after the Standard Model was first written. But in fact, it didn't occur until the 1980s. And of course, it was Weinberg, because Weinberg thinks like an effective field theory. That's how he thinks. So he was the one who said, let's write down what possible higher dimension operators could exist in the theory. People had discussed things like proton decay. In fact, the proton decay operator was miraculously written down in 1967 or something by Andrei Sakharov, because he realized you needed to have baryon violation in order to explain baryogenesis. And he wrote this down at a time when most people didn't believe in quarks and the Standard Model didn't exist, but he wrote down the four Fermion operator that you get in the Standard Model or in grand unified theories with three quarks and a lepton. Very ahead of his time. But it wasn't until the 80s that people said, let's systematically sit down and write down all the effective operators. And then again, it was Weinberg who first did it for the MSSM. Said, what are the most general operators you can write down in a supersymmetric theory? And it's a very interesting thing to do. So we talk about this for beyond the Standard Model physics. So we start adding higher dimension operators. There's nothing sacred anymore about dimension four. The reason why we write down the theory of dimension four is because those are the important operators. But there are going to be very subtle effects that could come in higher dimension, and we're interested in those, especially those operators that violate global symmetries of the lower dimension theory. So the leading thing you can write down is dimension five. That's the first correction to the Standard Model. And to understand what you can write down, you have to, of course, know what the gauge symmetries are. So we know the Standard Model, we have SU3 cross SU2 cross U1. And if I look entirely at the left-handed fermions, I've got a quark doublet, which is a 3, 2, 1, 6. We have a lepton doublet, which is a 1, 2, minus a half. We have the right-handed anti-up quark, which is a 3 bar, 1, minus 2/3. We have the down, I'll put a C here, so remember it's the antiparticle. And the electron, positron. So if you couldn't write those down with your eyes closed, I recommend you go off and you get maybe a tattoo or something, you know, put on your arm. Okay, and then we also have the Higgs, which is a 1, 2, minus 1 half. But we can also define H tilde, which is epsilon ij H star j, which is a 1, 2, plus a half. Did I do that right? I think that's right. So we want to make combinations of these fields in a way that and of course we've got the gauge fields, which are, we have F mu nu and G. Say B mu nu for the U1 and W mu nu A for the SU2. And so these are dimension two things, and dimension one and dimension three halves. So the first thing you can see is that if you have one quark, you have to have either an anti-quark or you have to have three quarks, because it has to be color neutral. If you have a quark and an anti-quark, you've already used up dimension three, and you don't have an operator that looks different from anything in the Standard Model, except for, of course, maybe it has a weird flavor thing. But so the only thing you could do with a quark and an anti-quark is stick in some Higgses, and that would just look like a correction to the mass. And I suspect it's not even possible to, no. So if you have a quark and an antiquark, then it's going to transform like a doublet. So the only thing you can put in is one Higgs, not two, because you can't make two Higgses transform like a doublet. And all you've done is recreated the quark mass, the dimension four operator. So the dimension five operator cannot involve quarks. So if you have leptons, it can't involve four lepton fields, because that would already be dimension six. So it has to involve two lepton fields. Two lepton fields is dimension three. And so if you want dimension five, you need to have two Higgs fields as well. So the only thing you could possibly write down in dimension five is two leptons two left-on fields, and two Higgs fields. Now, I was a little bit quick to rule out something with two quarks, because in QED, it is possible to write down a dimension 5 operator, which is quite interesting, or two of them, actually. You could write down E bar sigma mu nu E F mu nu. This is an anomalous magnetic moment operator. Or you could do E bar sigma mu nu E F dual mu nu, which is even more interesting, because that's the electric dipole moment operator and violates CP. So you say, well, why didn't I write down one of these operators for the standard model? And the answer is that the chiral structure of sigma mu nu is like a mass term. If you have a left-handed one here, you have to have a right-handed one there, because the gamma 5 commutes with sigma mu nu. So you need to combine lefts and rights, and if you do that, you have a problem, because the lefts are doublets and the rights are singlets, and the Fs are either singlets or triplets. So you can't make an SU2 singlet out of this. There is no way to write down an operator like this in the standard model. This is QED. I can't do it in the standard model unless I throw in an extra Higgs, which is normally how I couple lefts to rights. And so you see, this is now dimension 6. Furthermore, an operator like this, it turns out, would tend to renormalize the Yukawa couplings, and hence the masses for the fermions if they were unusually large. So in fact, not only is it dimension 6, but it'll also be proportional typically to the fermion mass, which for an electron would be very small compared to the weak scale. So we don't have any of those. So the only thing we can do is two lepton fields and two Higgs fields. And with two Higgs fields, they have to be either in an SU2 singlet or triplet. If you only have a single Higgs field, as you do in the standard model, unlike in the MSSM, you can't make a triplet you can't make a singlet out of the Higgs, because that would have to involve anti-symmetrization in the SU2 index. So the two Higgs fields have to be in an SU2 triplet. Because a singlet, we have to be H alpha H beta epsilon alpha beta, which is 0, because that's a boson. Okay. So it has to be in a triplet. So there's only a single operator you can write down. You put the Higgs in a triplet, and then you've got two lepton fields. And if the Higgs is an SU2 triplet, the whole operator's got to be SU2 singlet. It has to involve two L fields. It can't involve the E conjugate field, which is a SU2 singlet. So the only operator you can write down can be written in this form, where you can always write in a form like this, where this is an SU2 singlet. And I guess the way I wrote it, I really should put the tildes there so that the U1 charges cancel. And what LH tilde really means is these are both doublets, and I'm an epsilon alpha beta here to make it an SU2 singlet. Or alternatively, I could have written it as LH dagger. Okay? So here I have this dimension 5 operator. Now, it's the only operator there is, except there is one thing, which is that these leptons come in flavors. So in principle, I could have an I and a J here, and a CIJ, so it's some flavor structure. And then, because it's dimension 5, it's got to be suppressed by some mass scale lambda. So what is the effect of this operator? Well, the Higgs. So this thing has isospin plus a half, which means that its upper component has charge plus, and the lower one has charge 0. And so it gets a VEV, which looks like 0 V over square root of 2, where V is 250 JeV. And so what you're going to get then is that you're going to end up, when you pick out the lower thing and you've got the epsilon in there, you get something that looks like nu V squared IJ CIJ over 2 lambda. So equals. So it's a neutrino mass. And the thing that's interesting about it is that it's proportional to the weak scale squared divided by this new heavy scale. And so this is just a generic thing about high dimension operators, is that they're always suppressed by some heavy scale. And if the heavy scale is high, the effect is very small. So you have what is called the seesaw mechanism here. But the seesaw mechanism really is nothing more mysterious than if you have a weak interaction, if you have a high energy scale giving rise to this high dimension operator, dimension 5 operator, it'll give rise to a very small effect in the low energy theory, in this case, a small neutrino mass. So if we just plug in some numbers and say that you want to have a neutrino mass of 10 to the minus 2 electron volts or something, just a sec, I lost my page. So if you want m nu, 10 to the minus 2 electron volts, then you find that you need to have lambda on the order of 6 times 10 to the 15 JeV, assuming the C's are order 1. Okay, so this is a really cool way of explaining why neutrinos are so light. Now, this is not the only explanation. It's possible that the way the neutrinos get a mass is exactly the way the electrons get mass. Namely, there's another field in the theory, a right-handed neutrino, which is a singlet under everything, and I could have a Yukawa coupling with the lepton doublet H tilde and N, and I just have to make this extremely small. And then the mass of the neutrino is extremely small. Now, the thing that's interesting about this is that I can define lepton numbers, so L carries lepton number 1, and NC carries lepton number minus 1, and this conserves lepton number. But here, there's no way this conserves lepton number. This violates lepton number by 2 units. So there's a way to distinguish between this, which is called a Dirac mass, and this, which is called a Majorana mass. And the experiments that they're going to do this is look for neutrinoless double beta decay. So this is an experiment where you have a beta decay, and what comes out is, say, a positron and a nu e, and another positron and a nu e. But then these guys marry each other with this delta L equals 2 operator, and so the neutrinos never actually come out. So you have a beta decay, which a double beta decay, 2 positrons come out and no neutrinos. So the positrons are going to be, you can tell that there's no neutrino because of the energy spectrum of the positrons. Okay, and so they're building these very sensitive experiments looking for this. It's a doubly weak process. It's very slow. There's lots of background, so they have to have tons of detector, and it has to be deep underground, and it's extremely expensive. But these experiments are being funded and developed right now to try to see whether you can prove that the neutrino mass violates lepton number. So this is actually an unsatisfying picture. It could be true, but it's unsatisfying because there's no explanation for why the neutrinos are light. Well, this is a beautiful way of explaining why neutrinos are light. It's just that the lepton violating physics occurs at a very high energy scale. I'm sorry? Yeah. And people like lepton number violation as a way of getting baryon number into the universe. So there are many reasons to like this. And it's also, people really like the fact that this mass scale, which is going to turn out to be the same scale you get from proton decay as a likely place where grand unification can exist, is another reason to like it. But it actually gets even more convincing if you ask, well, what is the short distance physics that could give rise to this operator? And so what you want to do then is you want to look at it and say, let's assume, I'm going to make one big assumption, which is it comes from some tree-level exchange, just like the Fermi interaction. So let's ask, what are the possible diagrams could give rise to that? So you could say that I've got my L and my H, and then another particle, and then an H and an L. And I could say that these guys are in SU2 singlets. SU2 cross U1 singlets. So that means that the particle that goes across here must also be an SU2 cross U1 singlet. And so the quantum numbers of this guy under color and SU2 and U1 is a 110. Okay, well, we just saw a picture of a particle like that. We call that our right-handed neutrino. So all you have to do to generate this operator is put in a right-handed neutrino, put in your Yukawa coupling, but don't assume that the neutrino is light. Assume that there's a large lepton number violating mass term, lambda. So this violates neutrino number by 2 units, but now the mass is up at the 10 to the 15 JeV, and you also have your Yukawa coupling times NC H tilde L, which I wrote before, but this is not a Dirac mass because this neutrino is not in the low energy theory at all. You integrate out the neutrino from this diagram here, and this propagator gives you a 1 over lambda and generates that operator with a Y squared. So that's sort of explains a little better why this is called the seesaw mechanism. People said that the heavier the right-handed neutrino is, the lighter the left-handed neutrino. So one side goes down, the other side goes up. But that's not the only possibility, because it turns out you can also arrange these guys so that LH transforms like a electroweak triplet with charge, hypercharge zero. And so now you get the exact same picture. But now you've got some other weird type of fermion here, which transforms like a 1-3-0. So it's an object which is a color singlet, an SU2 triplet, and hypercharge zero. That's another way of generating this operator. There's one more. What sort of diagram could I draw that doesn't look like those two? Any suggestions? So the two L's on one side and the two H's on the other. Now, because these are two fermions, that has to be a boson. And I already told you that the H could only be in a triplet state, because otherwise, because of the anti-symmetrization would make it vanish otherwise. So here's a phi field, which is a SU2 triplet with hypercharge minus one. If they're coming on the side. So those are the three types of possible neutrino masses, and they are, of course, called type 1, type 2, and type 3. Now, what about dimension 6? There are actually different types of dimension 6 operators that are interesting. They're the electric dipole moment operators I mentioned. There's a CP violating operator you can write down just entirely out of gluon fields. Again, that's due to Weinberg. Okay, it's just a pure glue operator that violates CP because there's a dual there. There are interesting flavor changing neutral currents, delta S equals 2, which gives KK bar mixing. Very sensitive to high energy physics. So for example, if you write down an operator that looks like S bar D over lambda squared, experiment tells us that lambda is bigger than, well, if this is CP violating, if the coupling has a phase in it, then you find that lambda has to be bigger than 1,000 TeV in order to be consistent with what we see in the Kalin system. So that's an incredible reach of information, way beyond what the accelerators have. And every time somebody comes up with a theory of flavor, operators like this will almost always kill the model, because it's very hard to make explanation for where flavor comes from without generating larger values for that. This sort of tells us that if there is a solution to where all the structure comes from in flavor, it probably comes from very high energy. Well, so in 1974, I guess, George I. Glashow thought that it'd be really neat if they could unify the standard model into a single gauge group. And they found that the minimal group that would contain SU3 cross SU2 cross U1, which had a single coupling constant, namely no U1 factors, was SU5. And the group theory worked beautifully, and George I., who was very young, 24, 25 at the time, went home very excited because the group theory looked so pretty. Okay. Now, the thing that is hard for you to realize probably is how conservative people were then about higher energy scales. So for example, when I came to graduate school in 1981, there was a paper that came out that year predicting that the top quark mass was about 13 GeV. And that was considered ridiculous, not because the top should be heavier than that, but because that was an unreasonably high number that nobody could possibly predict a particle's mass was 13 GeV with a straight face. That was just absurd. Well, so George I., back in 74, earlier, went home and he had a scotch to celebrate his great theory. And then he calculated a diagram, because the SU5 contains SU3 cross SU2 cross U1. And these have the gluons, the W and Z, and the photon. But of course, this has a total of 8 plus 3 plus 1 gauge bosons, and SU5 has 24. So there are 12 more gauge bosons in SU5 that we don't see at low energy, and these are heavy gauge bosons called the X and the Y. And he computed diagrams with the X and the Y here. And because the SU5 unifies, say, down quarks and the leptons in one multiplet and the quark doublets, the up quarks and the positron in another doublet, these heavy gauge bosons were able to mix quarks and leptons, and they did not have a well-defined lepton or baryon number, and they gave rise to operators that looked like QQQL, where these are a variety of operators, some of them singlets, some of them doublets. Okay, and so this gives rise to proton decay. So this is B, delta B equals 1, delta L equals 1. Violates lepton number, and so it could lead, for example, to proton goes to pi zero positron. And he calculated that and got very depressed and had another scotch. And then after the second scotch, he said, well, let's put this over some lambda squared and make lambda really, really, really big, which means that the grand unified scale would be very high. And he calculated what that had to be. And that's actually very easy for us to do here. So we have this operator where the three quarks come together, and well, this operator here. And the first question is, how does that match onto protons? Because we have three quarks there. So, well, let's ignore that for a moment and say we need to have a width. Width is the inverse lifetime, it has dimensions of mass. Okay, and we ask, well, how does this width go? Well, it's got to go like whatever lambda's fourth, because it goes like an amplitude squared. And since it has to have dimensions of mass, it's going to have to have some powers of energy upstairs. And where am I? I'm out of order here. So hopefully I'm not saying something stupid now. If it has dimension of energy, it must have an m proton to the fifth upstairs, because that's the only mass scale of the problem, because, say, a pi zero and a positron are pretty light compared to the proton, so we'll say they're massless. And then with a two-body final state, typically you'll have an 8 pi phase space or something like that. The rule of thumb, a two-body has 8 pi, then every successive particle brings in a 1 over 16 pi squared. That's pretty close to correct. And so this is the width. And if you ask yourself then, what is consistent with the lifetime of the proton, well, in Georgi's time, this told you that lambda had to be bigger than about 10 to the 15 JeV. And now, with limits on the proton lifetime, it goes like about 16 JeV. It's very difficult for experimentalists to change what lambda is very much, because it goes like lambda to the fourth. So even if you change your width by a factor of 10, it only changes lambda by the fourth root of 10. So this was really radical to say that there was new physics at such a high energy scale and that you could actually think about it. But they did, they published this. And then that now ties in with the lepton number violation scale. It was a very similar scale, so people are very excited about that. And a last note I should make is that if you try to unify this into a slightly larger group, which is SO10, you find that all of the fermions, there are 15 fermions in the standard model, and the minimal fermion representation is 16 for SO10. And you can fit in the quark, the leptons, the up quarks, the down quarks, you see, and you need one more particle, and that particle turns out to have the quantum numbers of the right-handed neutrino. And so it fits perfectly into this package. It's got to be unified at a scale which is similar to the scale we got for neutrino masses, and so this is a very popular model for where this operator might have come from. So something funny has happened here, which is that we have a high energy theory which has no baryon number symmetry or lepton symmetry at all, but at low energy it looks like we do have that symmetry. This is the moment I warned you about. Oh, that wasn't too bad. Okay, so how did that happen? And the answer is it's impossible to write down a dimension 4 or less operator in the standard model which violates baryon number. You need at least 3 quarks. And that's a fermion, so you need to have a fourth lepton. So dimension 6 is the lowest dimension possible. So this is what you call an accidental symmetry. It's sort of the opposite of what you've learned about spontaneous symmetry breaking, where the idea is that high energy you have a big symmetry and low energy it's hidden. Here you have the opposite, where you have an apparent symmetry at low energy and no symmetry at high energy. So this is called an accidental symmetry. So we say that B and L are accidental symmetries of the low energy theory, simply because we cannot write down operators that violate them that are relevant or marginal. So this actually, this phenomena explains something that's sort of curious, which is, you know, you might take for granted that lattice QCD can give you a good picture of what real QCD is like, but you have to ask yourself, you know, this lattice, it's this, you know, points in a grid, it doesn't have Lorentz symmetry, how does it work? How do I ever get the continuum back out of it? So the problem there is that lattice QCD, the underlying symmetry of the lattice is not the Lorentz group, it's the hypercubic group. A very small group compared to the Lorentz group, right? It's got just you know, the rotations of a cube, hypercube. So how is it possible that a theory with just the hypercubic symmetry can reproduce Lorentz symmetry in some limit? That limit being that they look at long wavelength excitations on this lattice of small spacing. So now you know the drill. You say, I'm going to write down a theory, I can represent my lattice theory by writing down all possible operators that are consistent with the gauge symmetry and hypercubic symmetry. And so these are the operators I'll get from my lattice theory. And then you can ask, which operators, what are the lowest dimension operators that are hypercubic invariant and not Lorentz invariant? Okay, so if you try to write down with, the operators in general are not Lorentz invariant, but you ask, what's the lowest dimension operator which is hypercubic invariant? But is not Lorentz invariant. Well, if you try to write down just the fermions, it turns out it would be something that looks like this. Now, you're used to the summation convention, and this looks really weird, okay? Because it's got four indices. You take four of the same indice, and then you sum them. But that's because it's not Lorentz invariant, okay? The summation convention doesn't hold. This is the lowest dimension operator you can write down with fermions that violate, that is, this is hypercubic invariant. It sort of stands to reason. You have four vectors, so it's got the four symmetry of the hypercube. But it's obviously not Lorentz invariant. But it is dimension six, because psi bar psi is dimension three, and the derivative is dimension three. So it has to be multiplied by an inverse mass scale squared, or in the case of the lattice, it's got to have a lattice spacing squared out in front. So when you take the lattice spacing to zero, or equivalently keep the lattice spacing fixed and look at very long wavelengths, this becomes an irrelevant operator and goes away. Now, if I had a vector field, I could write down the following operator. A1, A2, A3, A4. That is hypercubic invariant. Again, it has that sort of that fourfold symmetry, so you might be able to believe that, that when you do a hypercubic rotation, it'll change A1 and A2, or A1 and A3, or A2 and A4, and it's invariant under that. So this obviously is not Lorentz invariant, though. However, the reason why you can't write this down is because the only vector field in QCD is the gauge field, and this is not gauge invariant. So that's why lattice QCD is able to reproduce Lorentz symmetry in the continuum limit. It's because Lorentz symmetry is an accidental symmetry of the theory. Now, if you try to write down a lattice theory of supersymmetry, now you've got a problem, because for lattice supersymmetry, well, there you've got a problem, because, you know, in supersymmetry, fermion masses and boson masses are the same. So if I write down m squared, m1 squared, phi squared, plus m2 psi bar psi, if I'm trying to do, say, the Wessimino model, you can see that these are relevant operators, and if I mess them up so that they're not equal to each other, then I've broken the supersymmetry. And radiative corrections, because these particles are put on the lattice in different ways and have different interactions that know about the lattice spacing and everything, you'll find that that radiative corrections, even if you put them, tune them to be the same at tree level, radiative corrections will mess that up. And so because supersymmetry violating operators are relevant, it is not at all easy to write down a lattice theory that gives you supersymmetry in the continuum limit without excessive fine-tuning of operators against each other. Okay, so that's all I have to talk about today. I will, next time I will just mention one offshoot from the proton decay, something called partial compositeness, and then we'll start talking about radiative corrections.